Okay, the next item of business is a statement from Hamza Youssef on NHS endowment funds. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions on his statement afterwards, so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to provide an update to members on the independent review of governance of NHS endowment funds. In 2019, the then Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport commissioned the review to consider and provide recommendations on changes that could be enacted to strengthen governance arrangements for NHS endowment funds. The review is being published today, and in my statement I'll summarise the key findings and recommendations alongside, of course, our next steps. Before I do, it is important to provide some context both in the need for the review and for the resulting recommendations. In terms of background, members will be aware that NHS endowment funds are charities. There are 16 such NHS-linked charities in Scotland, each registered with OSCAR, the charity regulator. The underlying legislation is contained within the NHS Scotland Act 1978. This gives power to a health board to, and I quote, to accept, hold and administer any property on trust for the purposes relating to any service which is in their function, to make arrangements for, administer or provide, or to their function with respect to research. End quote. Each charity is therefore a trust, and in line with the 1978 Act, the charity trustee of each NHS-linked charity is the related NHS board, acting as a single corporate trustee. This means that board members of the NHS board also act as trustees of the related charity. The decision to commission the review, as members will remember, was prompted by a report from OSCAR in February 2019, following their inquiry on the use of endowment funds by NHS Tayside. OSCAR found that while charitable assets were used only for the purposes of the charity, which are the same as those of the health board, there was inadequate separation of the interests of the charity and of the NHS board in decision making. OSCAR considered this an issue inherent in the structure of the charity, with health boards as corporate trustees, and recommended a review of the governance arrangements of the endowment funds and also of the 1978 Act in this respect. Before I turn to the findings and recommendations of the review, let me place on record my sincere thanks to the Chair, Julie Hutchinson, to the project team, to the reference group and the specialist subgroups, and to all those involved for the time and care that has gone into this review. I would also like to pick up on the point made by the Chair of the review, more of a reflection rather than a recommendation. And in her words, she says, "The report shines a light on a particular group of charities in Scotland which deserve to be better known." This is reflected in comments from one donor who observed that people may not know that they can raise and donate funds to a local and to their local NHS charity, and that beneficiaries may not know that charitable funds have provided something from which they have benefited. This review considers governance arrangements, and in doing so, it highlights the importance of the work of these charities and provides us with very helpful recommendations to support that work in the future. And I turn to the findings and the recommendations. The review found, as did OSCAR, that an inherent conflict of interest exists in the structure of the funds. First and foremost, this is seen in the dual role of NHS board members, who are also officers of the corporate trustee of the related NHS charity. In these dual roles, they are required to make decisions both on how to direct charitable funds and on managing board finances in order to deliver the required services and to meet the statutory requirement of financial break-even at year end. Let me be clear, it was not the finding of OSCAR or indeed of the review that there was widespread issues in the decisions being made on use of charitable funds. Rather, it is the case, as reflected in their findings, that the current situation puts health boards in a difficult position and open to criticism when making spending decisions on behalf of NHS charities. It is also the case that under the current legislation, the statutory purpose of the health board and the related charity are the same. As a result, the same item of expenditure could validly be incurred by the health board or by the related NHS charity. While there is no legal requirement to do so, to address this overlap, health boards have themselves established practices to separate out core spending and non-core spending. That is, those items to be publicly funded by the health board and enhancements to be funded by linked charities. However, there's no legally binding governing document for these NHS charities. It is this lack of separation between the health boards and related NHS charity that needs to be addressed. The review makes a number of recommendations, 28 in total, to do this and to improve the overall governance arrangements of these NHS charities. The most significant of the recommendations is replacing the existing corporate trustee with a charitable board, which would compromise an independent chair and a majority of independent members. This means a chair and a majority of members that are not drawn from the executive or non-executive membership of the related NHS board. The review also recommends publicly available and legally governing documents for each endowment fund and the introduction of limited liability for board members of endowment funds. It makes further related recommendations on recruitment and training of trustees and on communication, including ongoing interactions between the health board and the charity. Deputy Presiding Officer, I'll turn to our response to those recommendations and to the review and how we will take forward the recommendations in this review. I accept the recommendations of the review absolutely in principle, but there is some work to be done on precisely how we take forward these recommendations to ensure appropriate consultation, to ensure no unintended consequences, of course, and to support our NHS boards through implementation. The legislation governing the NHS charities dates back to the 1970s. As the review rightly sets out, times have moved on and so must we. There are significant sums held in these funds, and it's not just the money that we must protect, but of course the intent behind those funds. Since their establishment, many people have donated to these funds, often friends and family members of loved ones who have received care from the related health board, or indeed the recipients of that care themselves. They've donated in order to give back, to support the people and services that supported them in their hour of need, and to improve the experience for others in the future. This has never been more true than now, with unprecedented levels of donations to NHS charities seen throughout the course of the pandemic. As the chair of the review reflects, these charities are uniquely placed to play a creative and much needed role in supporting how we cope and recover from COVID-19. Trustees are required to consider the interests of the charity separately and distinctly from those of the health board. I fully accept that we need to ensure that structures and governance arrangements safeguard endowment funds and support those responsible to act in the best interest in the charities at all times. I also accept that the current legislation simply does not adequately provide for this, and that taking forward the recommendations from the review to separate the people and the purpose of the charity would address the inherent conflict of interest that I have spoken about extensively in this statement. As the review sets out, the creation of an independent board would provide trustees whose focus is no longer split between the health board and the charity and allow the charity to shape its own strategy, of course linked yet separate to that of the health board. Fully adopting the recommendations will require legislative change, and it will first require the precise mechanisms for that change to be determined. It will also involve significant work for our health boards. This will not be necessarily the quickest process, but of course we will ensure it moves forward with pace. It will require consultation with stakeholders, including OSCAR, and indeed NHS boards, and of course those who donate to our NHS charities. It will also require support for our NHS boards in taking forward this change when it comes. Deputy Presiding Officer, while changes will take time, I want to emphasise to members today my commitment to improving the governance structures and frameworks for our NHS charities. I will urgently explore what can be done now, before legislation is hopefully passed by this Parliament, what more can be done at this stage to improve governance and accountability on these important matters. This is a commitment that is shared and that we will progress with our NHS boards and with OSCAR.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Yousaf. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move to the next item of business. It would be helpful if members who wish to ask a question could press their request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, or place an R in the chat function if they are joining us online. And I call Craig Hoy. Mr. Hoyd, just a second, your microphone doesn't seem to be on. There you go.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of his statement. We welcome the publication of this review today. The review was first announced in 2019 with the aim of looking into how health boards use funds donated to NHS endowments following a scandal at NHS Tayside the year before. To quote the statement, there are significant sums held in these funds. It is not just the money that we must protect, but the intent behind those funds. Given this, can the Cabinet Secretary give us concrete assurances that all accounts of the charities will be made public, including income and detailed expenditures? And going forward, will he guarantee that any changes to NHS board endowments will have transparency at their heart?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think that's a very fair question from Craig Hoy. I hope in relation to my statement I was able to give some details of what boards are doing right now. And just to emphasise, there's a few safeguards. One, all trustees are required to act in the best interests of the charity. They're also required to publish an annual report and accounts, and within that set out spending plans and future strategy. And these are publicly available, and therefore they are open to scrutiny. But given how much interest there is in this, I will certainly impress upon the chairs and chief executives of boards when I meet them, and I meet them very regularly when I meet them next, just how important it is that if there are any changes made in advance of legislation, then those are communicated publicly. I think that's a reasonable expectation.
Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Cabinet Secretary also for advance sight of the statement. Today's statement should be welcomed, and Scottish Labour will take time to consider the range of recommendations made in today's report. The Cabinet Secretary rightly states that this process will not be a quick one, but could he advise the Chamber when he expects to have it completed consultations with relevant stakeholders and have brought draft legislation to the Chamber? And indeed, will he give more detail on who he expects to consult as part of this process? Will it include patients, families and families, patients and members of patients' families and those with a genuine interest in making the NHS Trust work on behalf of local communities? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
In answer to Karen Watkins' last question, absolutely. Consultation should, of course, be with donors, with patients, with the families of patients, as well as with OSCAR, with NHS boards, of course, themselves. In terms of her first question, a substantial question, I couldn't give her a date today. It would be wrong for me to suggest that I could. But she used the phrase that when could she expect the government to bring forward draft legislation? It may be that we're able to make the changes that we're looking to make with other legislation that we're considering, such as the reforms to charity law that we're considering already as a government. It may be that we're able to make that change. I couldn't say for absolute sure at this stage, so it may be that we're able to do that. If we are, that of course speeds up the process if we're able to have the relevant consultation in advance of that legislation. So what I can promise, Ms. Mochan, is that we will do this as quickly as we possibly can because I understand just how important an issue this is for all those concerned.
And Stuart McMillan, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And following on from Craig Hoy's question, can the Cabinet Secretary outline how taking forward a statutory corporation route for endowment funds would actually stop a repeat of the issues with the Tayside Fund?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, forgive me, I couldn't quite hear Stuart McMillan entirely, but I think he was asking about the statutory incorporation, which is one of the recommendations of the review. In that respect, yes, I think it would help with the issues, particularly around conflict of interest. What I would say is that's actually one of the areas I do wish to take a bit of time to see whether that is one of the recommendations that we can take forward, but could we take it forward or achieve the outcomes of that recommendation through another route? So, for example, could it be that these new NHS charity boards are set up as skills, for example, as opposed to necessarily statutory corporations? So there's pluses and benefits of both routes. But ultimately, at its absolute core, what that recommendation does is helps us in relation to that inherent conflict of interest that I expressed in my opening remarks.
Douglas Lumsden, to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Until recently, I was actually on the board of NHS Grampian, so I've seen myself firsthand the amount of valuable work done by the endowment funds. Does the Cabinet Secretary have any estimates on how much the changes announced today will cost the endowment funds? which will of course mean less for the charity to spend on patients and staff. I'm thinking, you know, would the chair and board members be paid, for example? Also thinking about new members of staff that may be going on to work for the charity, would they be included in the NHS terms and conditions, for example?
Cabinet Secretary.
Douglas Lumsden is right to raise all of these issues, and that's why we've got to take a bit of time to work through them. I wouldn't want any NHS endowment fund to be reduced because of the changes that we're making. So therefore, as a government, of course, we will look to see how we can absorb those costs and make sure that funding is given to health boards to be able to absorb those costs, as opposed to have to take those costs out of endowment funds. That is not why people give to endowment funds, NHS endowment funds. So I think it's a very reasonable point. But in terms of the second question, or second part of Douglas Lumsden's questions, I couldn't at this stage give him absolute definitive answers, but that is exactly why we want to consult with all the relevant stakeholders.
Michelle Thompson, to be followed by Paula Keane.
Serious governance flaws stem back to 1978 and the UK government legislation of that time that enshrined the conflict of interest. And I note the comments from the Cabinet Secretary that fully adopting the recommendation could require legislative change, and it will first require the precise mechanism for that change to be determined. So a couple of questions. Can you give any further guidance on that further legislation and perhaps challenges around it? And furthermore, is he issuing some interim guidance just now to boards regarding this conflict of interest, or is he relying on the OSCR report?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, I think they're both very important questions. On the first part of our question, I won't repeat or rehearse what I said to Carol Mockin, but we'll look to see if there's any other legislative avenue we can possibly use to move this forward at pace, as opposed to introduce completely separate primary legislation. On the second part of our question, it should be said that since these issues were first surfaced in relation to NHS Tayside, it would be absolutely the case that NHS boards have looked at their own governance processes and accountability processes and have themselves made positive changes. I think it's also important to note, and I'm sure no member has this impression, but I think it's really important to note from the OSCR report that initially into the NHS Tayside issue, that there wasn't widespread issues with the conduct of trustees. In fact, if I quote from that report, it says, "The picture has emerged from our analysis is generally positive and encouraging, and hope that this will reassure existing and potential supporters of these charities. By and large, the NHS endowment charities in Scotland have appropriate charters, operating instructions, policies and terms of references in place." So these documents do exist. Of course, where they need updated, and on the back of this review, my expectation would be that NHS chairs and boards look thoroughly at this review and make the appropriate changes if necessary.
Paula Keane, to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Public confidence in NHS charities is vitally important, and we must learn the lessons of what happened at NHS Tayside. And I recognise that the review by Julie Hutchison is a key part of this. I'm sure we were all inspired in the first lockdown by the fundraising efforts of Captain Sir Tom Moore, and NHS Scotland boards received a share of £4.4 million of that fundraising. And I think it shows the importance of endowment funds, because whilst the public may not know much about them, they have likely contributed to supporting them and would want to see the money well spent. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's intention to accept the recommendation to create independent boards of trustees to govern each charity. But does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that these boards must be more representative of patients and family carers? And what steps will he take to ensure that boards are representative of the communities they serve?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think, again, another set of very good questions. And on the first point raised by Paul O'Kane, what it does say to me and suggest to me is that people still do have confidence in our NHS endowment charities. That's why they've donated in record sums, and no doubt inspired by the likes of the late Sir Tom Moore, but others as well. On the substantial point he raises, it's an issue that I've raised with NHS boards. They all have, as you'd imagine, equality policies that they follow. But if I can be frank with Paul O'Kane, I'd like to see progress being made quicker and faster. And although our boards absolutely have equalities at the heart, not just in terms of racial equality, which has been an interest I know of this Parliament of most recent, but representation right across the board of protected characteristics. So there are policies in place. I am challenging boards to make sure they are more representative. I think he's right when it comes to these new boards that are created for charities. They must be representative, but we don't need to wait for those charity boards boards to be set up to see what we can do with our current structures absolutely in place. So, in short, we can do more and probably go faster in this regard.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
As the Cabinet Secretary has noted, huge sums have been donated to NHS charities during the pandemic. We also know that our boards are under intense pressure, including financial pressure. So what safeguards are in place to ensure that the funds are used as they were intended to be?
Cabinet Secretary.
Our, of course, funding of the NHS is at record levels, and we'll continue to ensure that our NHS is funded adequately, given the pressures that it's currently under. In terms of the safeguards, I spoke to some of those when answering a question from Craig Hoy earlier. It should be said that, as I mentioned in my statement, all trustees are required to act in the best interest of the charity. That is the first and primary safeguard. But they're also required to publish an annual report and accounts, and that has to set out in detail their spending plans. And, of course, these are publicly available and open to scrutiny. So those are the safeguards that currently do exist. On the back of this review, my expectation most certainly would be that every single NHS board looks in detail at this review, and if it has to update its procedures, its governance, its structures, then it should absolutely do that.
Alex Cole-Hamilton, to be followed by Marie McNair.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. We've heard several times today that in 2019, NHS Tayside was forced to give money back to the endowment funds following allegations of mismanagement. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that no other Scottish Health Board has been required to return money to the endowment fund on the same terms?
Cabinet Secretary.
Certainly not that I'm aware of.
Marie McNair, to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the pressure on NHS Board for remobilisation, is the Cabinet Secretary confident that the timescales for recommendations being taken forward can be met?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's a very fair question to ask because, of course, we all know and we debate regularly in this Parliament just how under pressure our NHS boards are. But I do think that this is an issue of extreme importance and therefore I expect urgency to be attached to the recommendations, given that this, as a number of members have said, is about public confidence. So, yes, while they remobilise, I would expect there to be some pace and urgency around these recommendations. And I will do my best because, of course, this will involve legislative change. I will certainly do my best to ensure that there is that pace and urgency from the government too.
Sandesh Gulhani, to be followed by Gillian McCann.
Apologies, Deputy Presiding Officer and Cabinet Secretary, for being late. I have experienced what all Glaswegians are at the moment in severe delays on ScotRail. These charities have given valuable equipment that I personally have benefited from in hospitals and thank all those who have donated to them. One of the recommendations is that each NHS-linked charity should put in a place a code of conduct to provide guidance and set expectations on board behaviours. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what is the timescale for putting these code of conducts in place? Who will review them before their implementation? And will they vary from health board to health board?
Cabinet Secretary.
So again, it goes back to my answer to his colleague Douglas Lumsden and others, that we'll obviously need to take a bit of time to work through these, to consult with the appropriate individuals. There are already, of course, in our current public appointments, including our NHS boards, codes of conduct that we expect those members to abide by. So we will make sure that they are absolutely robust. In terms of who we would consult with, I've already referenced in a number of answers to a number of members that we will want to talk to as wide a group as possible, but perhaps I left out clinicians, which is an important reminder that, of course, it is really, really important that those that are working in our health service, like Dr. Gohani himself, are consulted upon in relation to all of these matters, including a code of conduct.
Gillian Mackay, to be followed by Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. One of the recommendations of the review is that NHS-linked charities should put in place induction training for all charity trustees, as well as consider the need for ongoing training and support. Such training and support will be an important step towards widening access and ensuring a more diverse membership of NHS-linked charity boards. I appreciate the Cabinet Secretary's earlier answers to Paul O'Kane and Douglas Lumsden, but what measures, such as paying trustees and implementing training, will the Cabinet Secretary employ to ensure that our boards are more representative of lower socioeconomic backgrounds, ethnic minority backgrounds and disabled people?
Cabinet Secretary.
So while I can't, as I've said to others, give our absolute specifics, because we'll take some time to review the recommendations, I think the points that Gillian Mackay raises are exceptionally important, because we know that for a number of people, particularly in our diverse groups within society, that the fact that there is not the appropriate training, there is not the appropriate capacity building, there are perhaps financial disincentives for them to get involved in boards such as these NHS-linked charity-linked boards. These are all important issues, and issues that I will take time to reflect on, because, as Paul O'Kane and others have said, our boards should be as representative of the societies, should be as reflective of the societies that they represent.
And finally, Emma Roddick, who joins us remotely.
Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what steps have been taken to improve the management of these funds in advance of today's recommendations being taken forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I could probably be relatively brief, because I think I'll probably answer the question from a couple of people, that actually since this issue first surfaced, a number of boards, obviously all boards, looked at their own internal processes and governance around this issue. So changes have been made, but the most important safeguard we probably got in place is, of course, those plans or spending plans are published and open to scrutiny, which I think is really, really important. But there are a range of steps and measures that have been taken by boards since the NHS Tayside issue in particular did surface. My expectation now, if I can give some reassurance to Ms Roddick, my expectation now would be that since this review is published, that NHS boards would look at it urgently and see if their processes, their governance needs updated, and to do so at pace.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes questions on the statement. I'll allow a little time for front benches to change round.